What is the definition of first estate and second estate? The following question and answer about the meaning of the terms first estate and second estate in Abraham 3:26 is provided in the LDS Old Testament Gospel Doctrine Teacher's Manual found at this link. Quote, what do the terms first estate and second estate mean in Abraham 3:26? First estate refers to the premortal life, and second estate refers to our mortal life. We kept our first estate by choosing to follow Jesus Christ instead of Lucifer. What blessing did we each receive because we kept our first estate? The opportunity to be born on earth. What blessings will we receive if we keep our second estate? See Abraham 3:26. How we can keep our second estate? One of the disquieting things I've noticed over the last 30 years of trying to parse out the true history and doctrine of the LDS Restoration is that virtually every major doctrine of the Restoration has been corrupted or discarded by the modern corporate LDS Church. The above doctrine of first and second estate is no exception. I believe that the following passages actually reveal the fact that the first estate refers to our physical, tangible bodies during mortal probation, and that the second estate refers to the physical body after it's been quickened and added upon with glory into an immortal body of element. Look closely at the following passages. Quote, and we will prove them herewith, to see if they will do all things whatsoever the Lord their God shall command them. And they who keep their first estate shall be added upon. And they who keep not their first estate shall not have glory in the same kingdom with those who keep their first estate. And they who keep their second estate shall have glory added upon their heads forever and ever. End of quote. I admit, one can interpret verse 26 in different ways if it's read separately. However, verse 25, which I've included in the passage above and underlined, makes it clear that the first estate is where God is proving us in mortality. Our mortal probation is the first estate where he proves us. It's during our mortal probation that we are being proved as to whether we will do all things that God commands us. Those who prove valiant get to keep their physical estate after a temporary death and have it glorified and added upon. It's interesting that among the various definitions provided in the 1828 Webster's, the term refers to physical possession. A person's estate, in legal terms, often refers to their physical, tangible possessions. Our physical possession during this life is the physical body we inhabit. I would point out that Joseph Smith seems to interpret the above passages in the Book of Abraham the same way that I do. Notice the two diary excerpts by two separate listeners of Joseph's May 21, 1843 discourse. Smith's diary, quote, organization of spirits in the eternal world. Spirits in the eternal world are like spirits in this world. Even though spirits have come into this world and risen and received glorified bodies, they will have an ascendancy over spirits who have no bodies or kept not their first estate, like the devil. Devil's punishment should not have a habitation like other men. Devil's retaliation come into this world, bind up men's bodies, and occupy himself. Authorities come along and eject him from a stolen habitation. End of quote. The Smith Diary is identifying, quote, spirits who have no bodies, end of quote, who we need to have, quote, ascendancy over, end of quote, in the next world, as those that, quote, kept not their first estate, end of quote. Furthermore, Joseph identifies the devil as one of the spirits in the next world that failed to keep his first estate. Satan will be classed among the disembodied spirits in the next world. In other words, Lucifer apparently took upon himself a mortal body, but will not ultimately keep it. This teaching that Lucifer obtained a physical body is consistent with the narrative in Isaiah 14, which speaks about Lucifer being cast out of the grave at the day of judgment in his physical body. Quote, how art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. But thou art cast out of thy grave like an abominable branch, and as the raiment of those that are slain, thrust through this with the sword, that go down to the stones of the pit, as a carcass trodden under feet. End of quote. I've already blogged about this topic and the false doctrine that Satan and his followers were not allowed to participate in the first estate. I think the scriptures are clear about the fact that Lucifer and his followers in the pre-existence all come to a mortal probation to gain a physical body, even though they will ultimately become disembodied spirits. I do not want to reiterate all of the evidence for that, so you can read the article at this link if you have not already read it. Now let's look at the Richard's diary to find a third witness as to the definition of first and second estates. The Richard's diary, quote, "The first chapter of 2 Peter, it hints of things which are nowhere written. There are things which pertain to the glory of God and heirship of God with Christ, which are not written in the Bible spirits of the eternal world, are diverse from each other as here in their dispositions, aspiring, ambitious, etc., as man is liable to enemies there as well as here it is necessary for him to be placed beyond their power in order to be saved. This is done by our taking bodies, keeping our first estate, and having the power of the resurrection pass upon us, whereby we are enabled to gain the ascendancy over the disembodied spirits." End of quote. The clarification in the parentheses is part of the actual diary. I did not add it. So let me read the parentheses one more time. Keeping our first estate. So I'm going to read it again. "This is done by our taking bodies, keeping our first estate, and having the power of the resurrection pass upon us, whereby we are enabled to gain the ascendancy over our disembodied spirits." Richard is clarifying that Joseph was identifying the physical body of this mortal probation as representing the first estate spoken of in Abraham. The second estate appears to be the final glorified body, or at least the restored body that eventually becomes glorified. Another journal entry makes a statement that seems to contradict the above two diaries, and yet, when viewed in the context provided from the above diaries, it's easy to see what was really meant. I'll make the correction of what I think the person meant in bold caps. Quote, "When Lucifer was hurled from heaven, the decree was that he should not obtain an immortal tabernacle, nor those that were with him, but go abroad upon the earth exposed to the anger of the elements, naked and bare. But ofttimes he lays hold upon men's, binds up their spirits, enters their habitations, laughs at the decree of God, and rejoices in that he hath a house to dwell in. By and by, he's expelled by authority and goes abroad mourning naked upon the earth, like a man without a house exposed to the tempest and the storm." End of quote. Another related doctrine of the church that's been corrupted has to do with the doctrine of the resurrection. It's commonly taught in the church that after our mortal body dies, all men will be resurrected from the dead into our final immortal and glorified body. It's believed by many that perhaps this process takes place sometime during the millennium. Not true. The scriptures do not teach this. They teach that those who experience the death of the mortal body must first be returned to this earth and come forth out of the grave and be restored to that same mortal body to be judged. Sometime after they come forth in their restored bodies, the elect of God are quickened from a mortal body to an immortal body, not quickened directly from death to their final glorified body. Quote, "And the saints that are upon the earth who are alive shall be quickened and be caught up to meet him. And they who have slept in their graves shall come forth, for their graves shall be opened, and they also shall be caught up to meet him in the midst of the pillar of heaven." End of quote. Notice the very specific language used in the book of Alma declaring that the immortal body is raised from the mortal body, not directly from the spirit that is in the spirit world. Alma 11:45, quote, "Now behold, I have spoken unto you concerning the death of the mortal body, and also concerning the resurrection of the mortal body. I say unto you that this mortal body is raised to an immortal body. Then in Alma 12:20, quote, but there was one Ananias, who was a chief ruler among them, came forth and said unto him, what is this that thou hast said, that man should rise from the dead and be changed from this mortal to an immortal state, that the soul can never die? End of quote. Alma is stating that we gain a mortal body in this probation, then we die, then we're raised up again in our mortal body, then we are judged, then we are raised from our mortal body into an immortal body. Okay, here's the bullet points. Mortal body in mortal probation. Next bullet point, death. Next, restored from the dead to our mortal body after death has been conquered. Next, judgment. Next, mortal body raised to an immortal body. Countless patriarchal blessings from the time of Kirtland to the present day have promised the saints that they would stand on the earth in the flesh to see the coming of the Lord. Skeptics have scoffed at how many people have died without seeing the fulfillment of this prophecy, and yet it's always been an axiomatic verity in Scripture that everyone that has died after the crucifixion of Christ will eventually be returned to the earth at the time of the end of days, at the time of the coming of the Lord. Those patriarchal blessings will still be fulfilled. The book of Revelation notes how the wicked that are restored to their bodies will desire death, but will not be able to die. Quote, and in those days shall men seek death, and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them. End of quote. The term resurrection is not necessarily used the same way in the Scriptures all the time, nor does it always have reference to the final state of the immortal body. Notice in the following verse how it refers to the restoration of the mortal body to be judged prior to the final quickening into the final state of the soul. This is Alma 33:22. Quote, if so, woe shall come upon you, but if not so, then cast about your eyes and begin to believe in the Son of God, that he will come to redeem his people, and that he shall suffer and die to atone for their sins, and that he shall rise again from the dead, which shall bring to pass the resurrection, that all men shall stand before him to be judged at the last and judgment day according to their works. Notice how Alma 41 uses the word restoration in place of the word resurrection, proving that people are not brought forth from the dead in their final immortal and glorified bodies, but rather they are returned to the earth in the mortal bodies that they had during mortal probation. Notice that the judgment takes place directly after the restoration of mortal bodies. Notice that all of this is patterned after the resurrection of Christ, who said to Mary directly after being raised up, quote, touch me not, for I am not yet ascended to my Father, end of quote, indicating that his own process of returning to his final state was not yet complete. Alma 41, quote, and now, my son, I have somewhat to say concerning the restoration of what's been spoken. For behold, some have wrested the Scriptures and have gone far astray because of this thing. And I perceive that thy mind has been worried also concerning this thing. But behold, I'll explain it unto thee. I say unto thee, my son, that the plan of restoration is requisite with the justice of God. For it is requisite that all things should be restored to their proper order. Behold, it is requisite and just, according to the power and resurrection of Christ, that the soul of man should be restored to its body, and that every part of the body should be restored to itself. And it is requisite with the justice of God that men should be judged according to their works. And if their works were good in this life, and the desires of their hearts were good, that they should also at the last day be restored unto that which is good. And if their works are evil, they should be restored unto them for evil. Therefore, all things shall be restored to their proper order, everything to its natural frame, mortality raised to immortality, corruption into corruption, raised to endless happiness to inherit the kingdom of God, or to endless misery to inherit the kingdom of the devil, the one on one hand, the other on the other. The one raised to happiness according to his desires of happiness, or good according to his desires of good, and the other to evil according to his desires of evil. For as he has desired to do evil all the day long, even so shall he have his reward of evil when the night cometh. And so it is on the other hand, if he hath repented of his sins and desired righteousness until the end of his days, even so he shall be rewarded unto righteousness. These are they that are redeemed of the Lord. Yea, these are they that are taken out, that are delivered from that endless night of darkness. And thus they shall stand or fall. And thus they stand or fall. For behold, they are their own judges, whether to do good or to do evil. Perhaps one of the most fascinating and hopeful aspects of the doctrine of the resurrection is the possibility that among those that return will be some righteous souls that will be able to turn many to righteousness. And that's bolded, turn many to righteousness. If that interpretation is correct, it would mean that the restoration of the dead could begin before the time of probation is ended for those that are living. Quote, and many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life and some to shame and everlasting contempt. And they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever. End of quote. Section 88 informs us that it is after the first harvest of elect souls have been quickened and caught up into the cloud that the second harvest of terrestrial souls will come forth to be judged according to men in the flesh. That's bolded there, men in the flesh. This seems to indicate that the people will be able to do some things related to their level of salvation after they return from the dead and are restored to their bodies. Quote, and after this another angel shall sound, which is the second trumpet, and then cometh the redemption of those who are Christ at his coming, who have received their part in that prison which is prepared for them, that they might receive the gospel and be judged according to men in the flesh. End of quote.